morning.
Good morning.
I'm glad this morning, as Alan has called me. He's under the weather this morning, so. Our first hymn is Let Us With a Gladsome Mind for Voices United, 234. Reverend Art Hiley is our food donations that you can read for yourself there. Skip to number six. We are asked to pray for the mission and ministry of Bryanston United Church and for the well-being, compassion, strength, and joy of Paul Wallach, plus others involved in ministry leadership at this pastoral charge. And then there's the announcement in regards to Conference United Church Women on Saturday, April the 21st. Their theme is We Are One, and more information is there for you. And this morning, we would like to welcome Reverend Gary and Gwen to church this morning. Zach Cook is here. All the best to you in your recovery. And it is so good to see you both here. Blessings to you both, and we can visit with them downstairs during coffee hour. Are there any other announcements?
Thank you, Carol, and a very good morning to all who have come to worship with us today. I would like to join in Carol's welcome to our own Larry and Gwen. We have been looking forward to seeing you back and to full recovery for you, Larry. It's indeed a pleasure to have you here after 6 months of recovery, almost 6 months. It'll be 6 months in a few days. And we thank you for being here today. The people are delighted, and so am I. Welcome. At the head of the bulletin, under the rubric to ponder, certain religious practices and rituals help to provide a deeper sense of how we can live more fully and avoid contradictions. What would you consider to be an essential ritual in your religious life? You are invited to think through that question as the service unfolds. The call to worship is printed in the bulletin. I invite you to join me for the litany of the call. God's great love for the world offers healing from all our fears. We never have to earn God's love.
God is a perfect source of love.
Jesus came into the world to share God's freedom with us. Let us worship a God of undying love. Let us pray together. God, you summoned the morning sun to banish the darkness. We praise you for bringing peace out of despair and for restoring hope to the brokenhearted. You rule over the darkness that envelops us. Raise us by your presence, that our lives may be renewed, for your love is more gracious than the coming of spring. Amen. Our hymn, Jesus Did the Shine in Voices United, 585.
Jesus, did the shine, you are still alive, life that you can do.
We are focusing today in the fourth Sunday of Lent on energy consumption and deforestation. And our reader today is Sheila Dutton. And Sheila, I want to say it's a delight to have you up here. Since I've come, you have not come up here. And I know you haven't been well, and you have had a number of situations in your family that have prevented you from coming forward. But we're delighted to have you here today. Sheila and I go back a long way. I remember it was in 1993 or thereabouts that you, when you were president of the conference, that you invited me to be speaker at the ordination service in Sault Ste. Marie. Well, that's a long time ago, and we are glad that Sheila is here with us. Sheila will read the part of the reader, and I will read the part beside the bullets in italics. So Sheila will ask you to read now. Colombian Andes, 7,000 feet above sea level. The flow of ice from glaciers in Greenland has more than doubled over the past 10 years. At least 279 species of plants and animals are already responding to global warming by moving closer to the poles.
There is something that we can do to show our concern. Sunday, March the 24th, at 8:30 p.m. is Earth Hour. Vote for the Earth by turning out your lights for 1 hour. Earth Hour is gaining momentum. Millions of people around the planet are participating, and the effect is immediate and visible. As we extinguish this candle, we acknowledge that we have burdened creation with mountains of waste and pollution.
Let us join in our prayer confession that's printed in the bulletin. God of love, once again we are called to confess that we knowingly and unknowingly have been part of the problem of global warming. Help us to be part of the solution. Forgive us and help us to correct past wrongs with hope and energy for creation and for our brothers and sisters around the world. Giver of life, we who are made in the image of God have gone astray, and creation groans with us. Have mercy on us. Amen. We will sing, as we have for the last few Sundays, As the Sun with Longer Journey, number 111 and the second verse. We apologize for the spelling of debtor.
Amen.
today is an oboist in the person of Oscar Elias, and we welcome him to our service today. Thank you, Oscar. In your bulletins is an insert headed by the words Liturgy for Membership Transferred. We have two people who will become members of our church today in this liturgy, and I'd like to begin with a statement of purpose. The church is a community of people with varied gifts united by the Holy Spirit. We gather to celebrate God's presence and to discern God's truth. We promise to follow the way of Jesus. By our baptism and confirmation, we are made members of Christ's church. We exercise this membership in the denomination to which we belong, which for us is the United Church of Canada, within the context of a local community of faith. We will welcome into this congregation those who are already members of the Church of Jesus Christ. I want to read from the Pauline Epistle to the Christians living in the city of Corinth, from the first epistle and the 12th chapter. The Christian community in Corinth was a diverse community, and wherever there is diversity, there are problems. Paul had to write to this community and exhort them to become better members of Christ's church. And he does that by speaking about the varieties of gifts of the Spirit. Listen. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gift of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. This is the word from the Holy Epistle. We give thanks to God for this reading. I will invite the chair of the worship committee, Carol, to come forward now and present the candidate to be transferred.
On behalf of the congregation of Dorchester United Church, I present the following persons whom we welcome into the membership of this community of faith: Barbara Clark and Tabitha Carey.
Will you come and stand facing me at the table? Barbara and Tabitha, will you join with us together as we celebrate God's presence, live with respect in creation, love and serve others, seek justice and resist evil? If you do, will you reply as is written here?
I will, with God's help.
Thank you. Dear friends in Christ, let us rise and pledge to Barbara and Tabitha our support and care. Will you join with me as we say these words, which are printed in bold? As your brother and sister in Christ, we rejoice in the gifts she brings to us. We pledge to you our love and support. With God's help, we will together live out the mission and ministry of Christ's church. standing as we turn to Voices United, number 918. And I will have to return to my place to get that. A new creed was first published in 1968 by the United Church of Canada. It is not new anymore, but we still call it a new creed. It follows in the tradition of the three historic creeds of the Church, the Apostles' Creed, the Nicene Creed, and the Athanasian Creed. Let us repeat it prayerfully as an expression of our faith. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the Church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. In the name of Jesus Christ, we welcome you to the privileges and responsibilities of membership in this congregation. We give thanks to God for your witness among us. Carol will now give you the certificates of membership, which will indicate that you are members in full standing. Welcome. Welcome. The grace of Christ attend you, the love of God surround you, the Holy Spirit keep you. Amen. Go in peace. The insert, you will notice that we are moving now to the reading of Holy Scripture. On the fourth Sunday of Lent, we turn to the Pentateuch, which we have been reading from for some time, the first five books of the Bible. And within the Pentateuch is this weird book called Numbers. I dare say that we don't read from the book of Numbers very often, but today we are. The book of Numbers was in Hebrew called In the Wilderness. That was the Hebraic meaning of the book of Numbers. So we are back in the wilderness. From Mount Hor, they set out by the way to the Red Sea, so you know where we are in terms of the Exodus, to go around the land of Edom. But the people became impatient on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? We've heard that question before in the book of Exodus. For there is no food and no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents. among the people, and they bit the people, so that many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a pole. And everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole. And whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look at the serpent of bronze and live. A reading from the book of Numbers. Thanks be to God. The psalm for responsive reading is Psalm 107. You will find it at number 831 in Voices United, and we are reading parts 1 and 2.
God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world,
but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. A reading from the Gospel of St. John. Thanks be to God. Let us take a moment for silent prayer. The people of the covenant and the generations who came after them, Noah's people, those who survived the flood and lived under the sign of the rainbow, Abraham's people, those who inherited the promise of land and children, as many as there were stars in the heavens and sand on the seashore. The people whom Moses was called to lead out of slavery in Egypt into Canaan, the land of milk and honey. The people who had received the 10 words of promise on Sinai, words of life. The people were now dying in the wilderness, as the book of Numbers is styled in the Hebraic fashion. I have just recounted for you the three covenants that are in the book of the Pentateuch, or the books of the Pentateuch: the covenant with Noah, the covenant with Abraham, and the covenant with Moses. We have spent some time talking about covenants in the past. These are binding agreements in which people have an obligation to God. These are the covenants that we have been reading about in the Pentateuch. The people have been bitten by poisonous snakes whose venom left red, fiery marks on their bodies. It had been a long time since the bricks and taskmasters of Egypt. The cries of the people had reached the ears of God, and they were led out of the darkness of oppression into the light of God's freedom. The wilderness, my dear people, is the place where God calls the people of the covenant and the generations who come after. It is a place where serpents slither and snakes with forked tongues scream rebellion in your ears. It is a place where political leaders of every stripe plan their every move to speak contradiction and disharmony to confound the people. According to a British news source, the Russian Putin is using a rare poison to kill people he wants out of the way. Only this morning I heard on the news again that the two people are in dire straits in the hospital, and another policeman is also seriously ill. My dear ones, the wilderness is a place where the water that gives life no longer flows, and the people grow thirsty. The people have grown impatient because the food policy in the wilderness is not like the one they were used to in Pharaoh's Egypt. They remember manna falling in the night when they were asleep, and in the morning they had to eat until they were satisfied, but they may not keep any for the next day. You will recall that in the book of Exodus. My dear people, no investments of long or short term, no mutual funds, no RRSPs, no stockpiling of resources. The wilderness, on the contrary, is a place of dependence and trust. It is a Lenten place on a journey to God, who makes promises and keeps them. Maybe, just maybe, you and I need a Saint Patrick to come into our Ireland and rid us of all the poisonous snakes. Maybe we need a Pied Piper to come into our Hamelin and pipe all the rats into the sea. Horrid creatures, the ones that hurt us, are everywhere in the wilderness. Why doesn't God do something about the food crisis in Africa? Why doesn't the call of the United Nations Security Council to end the carpet bombing in eastern Ghouta, Syria, be heeded by Assad of Syria and Putin of Russia, who continue to carpet bomb eastern Ghouta? A convoy of trucks bringing food and essential supplies has been held up for days, while medical supplies have been raided from the trucks by Assad's goons. My dear ones, there are poisonous snakes in the wilderness, and they will bite you. The people are dying in the wilderness. Who are these poisonous snakes with forked tongues that bite the people and leave them to die? God doesn't tell us where they come from, nor do we know when and how this darkness came into our lives. Maybe you and I need a bit of Egyptian serpent magic, a remedy for the snake's venom in the wilderness. We need a Moses to place a serpent of bronze upon a pole and hold it up for us to see. Like a child smitten by cancer, who draws the oncogenes, which are the cancer genes, on a sheet of paper. We must circle them, run a line through them. In the wilderness, we complain about the things that hurt, about crop failures, and famine, and starvation, and tomorrow's health care, and a society in which our children have stopped coming to church and instead carry weapons to school. Maybe we should mount them on a pole, all the weapons we carry with us, so that we can all see them. I tell you, new life can only come from facing the darkness in our lives, not from driving it out. God told Moses that the very things that hurt the people had the capacity to heal the people. God knows that we all have a shadow side. God knew long before the psychotherapist Carl Jung knew. The shadow side can do a lot of damage unless it is brought out into the open for everybody to see. Why then are we covering up the high incidence of PTSD among returning military veterans? Mount your fears upon a pole, says God. In the wilderness, the things that hurt will also heal. We prefer not to face the reality of our complicity in the darkness of this world. So we come in the night like Nicodemus, hoping to find some answers, and we find a Jesus who calls us out into the open. Nicodemus hears things that are meant for the light. Serpents live in the darkness, when Nicodemus and the people of the covenant and all those who come after have lived for too long. Jesus told Nicodemus, and this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. My dear ones, words like these are hard to swallow for those who have been living for too long in denial. So Jesus becomes a great threat and source of fear, as the serpents in the wilderness do. That's why John, the gospel writer, said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. God lifts up before us that which we most fear. They were afraid of Jesus because he was telling the truth. In a strange way, my dear ones, the snakes become a symbol of our desire to conceal and cover up the truth. A symbol with mixed and conflicted meaning of evil and deceit and death, but also of healing and wisdom and fertility. Healing and new life happen when we lift up our fear and name it. In the Jordan Valley overlooking the Dead Sea, there is a monastery with huge poles upon which are serpents. In all the schools of medicine since the Greek Asclepius, the Greek god of healing, there has been a symbol of two snakes intertwined. Do we get rid of the snakes, or do we learn to live with them? God felt the full sting as Jesus was raised up on a cross for all to see. The impatient and the complaining, and those who come under cover of darkness because they prefer not to see, must live with the snakes, because the God who does not take us out of the wilderness will redeem the darkness. God will send Jesus to live in our darkness. For God so loved the world that God sent Jesus into the world. I remember a former pope, probably the first to go into Israel after many years, writing on a piece of paper, folding it and placing it in a crack of the wailing or western wall of the ruined temple in Jerusalem. The pope's action was magnanimous. It was a ritual for all to see. But God's action, let me tell you, is more than magnanimous. It is radical. For no pontiff will go to a cross. A pole on which is mounted an effigy of the dying Christ. God alone offers grace and freedom in the wilderness. And Jesus is hoisted up on a cross to die. To crucify once and for all the ambivalence of our human intentions. In the name of the God who created us, the Christ who is always redeeming us, and the Spirit who has now set us free. Amen. The hymn, Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound, number 266 in Voices United.
Thank you.
bless us with your power and presence. Bless our hands. May they reach out to other hands. Their grasp is sometimes weak, but their touch can heal in your name. Bless these feet of ours that walk and run day after day, that grow weary with standing firm, that hesitate wanting to quit, but that follow you in faith, a pilgrim's path. Bless these hearts of ours that often hold within more grief than they can carry, yet know you'd ask no more than they could bear. Bless these minds and spirits. O God of grace, conceive in us, for mercy's sake, a love for all the world. Creating God, God of justice and of joy, maker of so much peace and beauty, we seek to live disciples' lives in you. Bless our hands to your service, our feet to your path, our hearts to your purpose. Bless our spirits to the lure of your love. All honor, praise, and glory be yours as we lift up in your presence the people we know to be in the hospital, the people who have been in the hospital. We thank you for Larry, who has come among us again today as a sign that he will be with us in the near future. We ask you to bless him and strengthen him and his family. We thank you for Gwen, who is with him today and who has supported him throughout this long illness. Remember, O God, all whom we name in our hearts today, who have reason to long for your presence, for your healing hands. Loving God, look upon us now in this hour of petition and intercession on behalf of a world in pain. We ask this prayer in the name of Jesus, who taught us to use these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Open your hands and let God touch them. Open your hearts and let God renew them. Open the fountain of love that pours from the heart of God, that we may offer up gifts worthy of Christians. The morning offering will now be received. prayer. Merciful God, we live in a country where we are recipients of many rich and varied resources. As we offer up these gifts, let us be mindful of the rest of the world where death from starvation and wanton killing are commonplace. May you grant us the courage to see beyond our own needs to a world that is longing for change. Amen. You may be seated. The hymn at number 274 in Voices United, Your Hand, O God, has guided. Everyone you meet, see the face of Jesus in you. And the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit, our Comforter, be ours this day and evermore. Amen.